Bars I-95, Connecticut's number one rap hip hop platform, home of the heavy bar spitters. As y'all can see, we all the way in LA. I had a rundown on my homie, my brother, King of LOM himself.
The energy God.
Energy God is officially in the building. I just wanted to take a quick time out of the freestyle and just catch up with Hollow. He got a lot going on. Brand wise, I know you know LOM, the brand.
For sure.
You revamped it a little bit and you did some changes, made some upgrades.
Yeah, the hidden label.
Yeah, so let's talk about that real quick. Let me know what you got going on as far as the business end goes right now.
That's definitely the foundation was LOM. We broadcasted everything as far as it motivated. And then I moved on to Hidden Label. Let me not say moved on because I added on to LOM.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because I still do both, but that's more of a high-end cut and sew, like everything handmade brand, and LOM is just like, the motto, loyalty over money, what we live by. So, that's more important for a message rather than, going over the top fashion-wise.
Right,
you know what I mean?
And you also just recently, which I downloaded a joint, a project you just recently dropped, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just talk briefly about the project.
The only good thing in 2020, man, ain't been too many good things. And I came back, took 5 years off, just focused on battle rap and propelled that to the next level. That's around the time I battled Lux, Buttons, Clips, passed it all back to back, like 14 to 17, 18. So, aiming to do the same thing with the music as far as just focus on one thing and, put my joint on that. So it's streaming now, but when I first dropped these projects, it's only on lomclothing.com for digital download. Like, you can get a digital as soon as you buy it, boom, you got the whole joint.
Yeah, I remember you sent me my joint email.
Yes, sir.
I want to highlight that real quick. You actually one of the few battle rappers that I don't really label you as a battle rapper. You're more like an entrepreneur. You know
for
what I'm
sure.
saying? And I love seeing that in the battle rap culture because me and my partners, we always ask each other and we tapped into the battle rap culture a lot. And we always talk about the business of battle rap culture and what more could be done for battle rappers and what are they doing in their positions to better their situations. And it's only a handful of rappers that actually are doing more beyond battle rap.
Mm-hmm.
And you being one of the veterans, you actually partake in that. You have your LOM, you have your music, you have other things you partake in.
Sure.
Just briefly talk about that because I think that's what's missing in battle rap. I don't know if the younger battle rappers know it by now, but being in a position of being, having that platform is not it. That's not the only thing you should be doing.
For sure.
So just talk to me briefly about your process and like what brought you there.
Well, one thing I always remain a focus on is social media is really made as a networking tool. And I've always been on there broadcasting, whether my website or a new product. A lot of people forget that. They go on there, they show pictures, they talk. If you're an entertainer, entrepreneur, they should be able to go to your page and see some relevance of what your brand is and what you represent. And you go to people's page and you'll see LeBron James, you'll see, weed and shit. So you definitely got to put that first. Now, as far as in battle rap, I definitely started with the clothing brand and branched off to getting a 501c and doing philanthropy work. You've probably seen some videos if you've been on URL. Of stuff I done did, and then from there, that's when I did the hidden label, and the focus now is the music, and then I'm tapping into like a management bag of helping other artists.
Right.
So that's the future goal.
Right.
But those are just some avenues I took from starting a business and promoting that. In the Clips battle, it was probably the first time I was like pro entrepreneurship.
Right.
And then I did the 501c, and So
right.
I've made moves outside of battle that most battle rappers,
right.
Like you said, aren't doing. So it's to inspire, the next ones coming to do the same. Like, do something that you might not think would be cool, but you're into, or
right.
something you want to do.
Right.
So,
I've seen the posts that you've done recently and stuff that you was talking about and you touched on. I think that's important. Like, I see you as being one of the OGs that actually could be the one to let them know, like, yo, this is how you move.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it's all bad out there, but yo, if you're in this shit, this is how you would move. Now, I commend that because somebody should be in the battle rap business to capture everything and propel from it. You know what I'm saying? And you're doing that. And obviously, you're learning the industry, too. You're actually building from it. And And I want you to talk from that perspective right now, from like the artist. I seen a post you did the other day where you was talking about, like, yo, if y'all need to review your contracts, and just talk to me where that comes from. Like, where are you coming from?
Just me working from entertainment period, from television shows, from NBC, I mean, TBS, MTV, you know, and Adult Swim. I've done several shows also, like, music-wise, battle rap-wise, and entertainment period. You know, you have no leverage in room in these contracts. You know what I mean? Like, even to ask for more money is crazy. So picture someone asking for, you know, rights to their likeness, or maybe, you know, an option if things don't work out for them to have their likeness back. Like, there's no type of budging room with none of these companies. And it's really like a dog-eat-dog type thing. And my thing is, like, you know, people say that's business, but, you know, you could also apply new business models. Like, you know, I run on an ethical business, you know what I mean? And that means not all money is good money from how I roll, you know what I mean? So I was knocking more because I came up with these dudes, and then on top of that, we promote black business, and we black, and we just following how Walmart do business. We gonna follow how McDonald's do business. Like, what makes them reputable for me to be like, well, this is how business goes? And that's what they said, like, you feel me? So it's just following the follower. So I felt like, yo, I gotta, with all this stuff transpiring, I gotta, like, say something, because if I don't, like, it's kind of gonna be like a regret.
Right, right. And like I said, I commend that. And we don't really, a lot of people on the outside, us fans of battle rap, we don't know what's how the contracts are put together. We don't know, like, we hear it in the music industry. We hear how people sign to bad record deals. And does that exist in battle rap? Like, a bad battle rap deal?
It's worse. It's worse than the music industry, because when the music artists were getting raped in the early 90s, at least they was getting 60 cents off an album.
Right.
You know, we don't get nothing off of residuals paid to YouTube.
Right.
And, you know, people, and it's a funny thing because people, well, let me not even get into that. Let me stick to fuck what people say.
Yeah.
But, the main focus is like, bro, in the 90s, they were still getting show money. They was able to tour and do other stuff outside of their albums. Like, we just battle rap, you know what I mean? And it is room to cut some dudes in to get some type of residuals for, like, you know, the top dudes that help carry the torch.
Right. And to highlight that a little bit, and again, you being a veteran, you know how to move.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen you talk, and I've seen you in interviews where, even in battle rap, where you mentioned lines of certain battles, you was able to work something out, and you knowing this, you being in a position to do it, and other battle rappers not being able to do that. And what do you say about that? What do you say to that type of situation?
You know, you're always in a position, because my first battle was Big T on URL. They wanted me to do that for the very, very first URL event. And I knew that Math and Rex was getting paid for their battle. So I'm like, there's some type of budget, but they wanted me to do it for free. You know what I'm saying? That's why on the freestyle, I just said, you know, cousin want a freebie, acting like he, but, you know, I cut it off, you know what I mean? But, you know, the first joint they wanted for free. And it was like, you know, I need to get compensated something. You know what I mean? But I was still wanting to be on Smack. Like, this is just like the NBA. So it's like, but I knew what I stood for and what I represented. You know what I mean? So I was like, yo, if they respect me and they respect my craft, they gonna give me something. You know what I mean? So even at a low level, when I needed Smack and them, I still did that. And I waited two more events to battle on Smack. You know what I mean? But since I did that, they respected me from the gate.
Right.
They knew, like, oh, we can't come with him with no ah, like, he's not an Ogie. So you always got to stand up for what you represent for later on down the line. You know what I mean? Or you never going to get your respect as far as in business. So I say to them cats, like, in your field, you're a hollow the dome. You know, it's a cat in Michigan right now that's, you know, popping in his hood. And, like, you got to stand up and represent for, like, you know, whatever it is you feel like is being wrong or not justified in business or how shit is going.
Right. So your message that you want to relay to the newer up-and-coming battle rappers, are you open for them to reach out to you and, like, talk to you about situations that they got going on?
Yeah,
for sure. Is that okay for them to reach out to you?
Yeah, I already opened an invitation, I think, on Instagram or something. I said, like, you know, I've already talked to a few cats, you know what I mean? And it's just about passing the game on, because I feel like we hide so much information from each other, you know what I mean? Just to stun on each other, you know what I mean? Like, we hide information and pop up, you know what I mean? Like, so I think sharing information is one of the keys to getting to a higher economic level.
Okay, just to bring it back and with your business and your brand, I actually think you should be one of the guys that look into being like the representative, like to represent artists in there. And there's a market for that. You know what I'm
saying?
For sure. I feel like Smack and URL as a whole, just battle rap as a whole, is such a, it's still a baby. It's still growing into what it's gonna be. I feel like there's so much room for it to become more than what it is. Like the NBA, like the, exactly. You know what I'm saying? Like there's so much more dynamics and departments it's gonna eventually turn into.
Oh, for sure.
And then before that happens, like seeing what you're doing is kind of like ahead of its time, because anything, you know more than anybody, if you start trailblazing on anything that's new, you're gonna get a lot of flack from it, mm-hmm. because it's new. Like everything, like I seen all the things people were saying about the post that you did, but I see the attention behind it. I see where you was coming from, what you were trying to do. And that's like trailblazing. Anytime you're trailblazing on an idea that eventually could be something, people gonna hate you for it.
Yeah.
But a year from now, you turn around and 10 other people are doing it. Like, yo, this nigga just opened up a company where he's reading all Smack contracts for all. Like, I don't know. I'm just saying.
No, I get what you're saying.
A bunch of departments could be opening up because it's such a new thing in the industry. You know what I'm saying?
Like, you're 100% right. And it's definitely something that's been talked about. And that's why I said a management company in the future, you know, I would definitely love to put like battle rappers under that.
Right.
You know what I mean? But I'm more like teaching classes and people like to start their own clothing brands and stuff like that was the main thing. But I definitely want to work with some battle raps, and I've already attempted to. But you know, it's different coming from your peer.
Right.
They look at me a little different, and that's just like, you know, I don't want to focus on the negative part about it, but it's like if cats is looking at you like a peer, it's very difficult for them to let you make money off them.
Absolutely.
Or like, you know, they'd be like, they'll feel the type of way, you know what
Absolutely.
I mean? And then they think I might bring it up and throw in their face if we have a disagreement.
Absolutely.
So it's definitely something that's being worked on though, for sure.
Yeah. And like I said, I commend that. And, you know, I say you keep that going because, you know, whether you're getting flack about it, whatever the case may be, you're headed in the right direction. I think it's fair. I'm in the business of being fair. You know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
And I think that's it's only right for such a great thing in the culture. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Battle rap has been holding it down. Culturally, I think battle rap has led the culture of hip hop for the past 10 years. People are just coming back to the whole rap thing now with Griselda and such and such. But
shout out Griselda.
Right. But the feel of actually rapping, the hip hop sense of it, battle rap has been carrying that for 10 years.
Sure.
And you guys, for me, the industry, and I watched it from battle rap to industry, I study both businesses. And my thing is to just see the progress of battle rap. I love the fact it's on apps and shit like that now, but let's move it towards success of each individual's, the leveling of each. If he's a veteran, let him be that veteran status where he's treated like an NBA veteran.
Yeah,
like
exactly. It like should be a certain. It should be a pay rate. You know what I mean, for levels. You know what I mean. So I think that would be fair, but you know, it really got to be decided by the people that's the leagues that's actually the league owners. You know what I mean.
What do you think would be a recommendation or something that you would want to tell the league owners to
say. Like a union, like I just said, like, you know, a certain pay rate for like veteran, mid-tier, lower guys, you know, it's a certain pay rate level, you know, it should be a minimum just to represent your brand and stuff like that. And, you know, it's fair wage, like you said, about going about stuff. And, you know, it's very, very difficult to be like a capitalist and a conscious black man at the same time. It's very hard because, you know, people are going to, you know, throw stones at you and stuff like that. So, you know, I definitely don't want to like knock anybody that's, you know, just out here doing their thing. But it's like, you got to live with, if the workers are suppressed or like the artists feel suppressed, you got to deal with the backlash.
Right.
Like this ain't coming from nowhere. People might forget, but you know, Murder Mook, you know, went at them about the DVDs and him never getting paid. And Lux dropped a song around Summer Madness, the Smack Diss. So, you know, I'm not the first person.
Right.
But the reason these newer fans are people that might not have been around us like the Godfathers is because we've been doing this before Smack. before Beasley, right. before we've been, that's why me, Mook, and Lux could talk like this.
Right.
Like, we've been doing this since the late 90s, before they was doing this. Like, this battle rap, we've been in this. We the seniority to like Beasley
that's
and that. Like, if we keeping it real.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, other cats can't stand up like that because they grew up on smack. I grew up doing this.
Not right.
You know what I mean? Like, I grew up doing this in real life. So they can't talk that talk like, you know, maybe a verb or, you know, but I can, dog, because we've been doing this long and it's like the pioneers that help hip hop and niggas be disrespecting them. Like, fuck Rock Kent. You know what I mean? Niggas just say crazy shit, but it's like, you got to remember who, you know, laid the foundation. So,
and like I said, that's why, you know, I had to make sure, you know, I catch up with you because I know you have a lot going on musically, rapping wise, battle rap, and brand your business. You got so much going on that it's I respect battle rap culture too much not to, you know, talk to y'all about what's happening. You know what I'm saying?
It's a lot to talk about.
Yeah, it is a lot to talk about. Like, we could be up here talking for hours, but, you know, me and you think I kind of want to touch on because a lot of up-and-coming battle rappers want to get on this show. They're trying to get bars off. I want them to stop for a second and understand there's strategies behind battle rapping. Now, back then when it was all for the passion and you was nice and trying to prove that you're the nicest, you have to understand now it's more business than it ever been. And also understand it's not just battle rapping.
It's not easy.
Yeah. So, you know, I appreciate you making it down to show.
Yes,
like I
sir.
Said, we came all the way down to LA to catch up with Hollow, and it was necessary for me to catch up with him on anything he got going on. So, appreciate you coming down here, my
brother.
Balls I-95, make sure y'all tap in, press that subscribe button. I appreciate everybody's been tapping in. Mike Zombie's in the building. Shout out to Mike. We over here chilling right now.
Subscribe now.